It's a good morning to you. Welcome to Asake Online. My name is Zenzele Ndebele, and this is the Breakfast Club. Today in the program, I'm taking COVID. We'll be talking to someone who was at Elangen Training Center, which is now an isolation center, to find out what she learned, what changed her, how it was easy for her to go to the isolation center. Like we have been saying the past few weeks, that there's a lot of misconception about these isolation centers, and people, when they're asked to go to isolation centers, they think that they're going to die, they think that they're going to go hungry. At the end of the day, putting lives to those who are at risk that they'll be staying with them. But we want to find out from those who have been at Elangen Center to share their experiences. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Yeah, my first question to you is, tell me, what happened for you to go test? Why did you end up testing for COVID?
All right. Well, I work here. I work at the church. So I actually had symptoms, I think, around the 4th of November. Just started feeling dizzy. I started coughing, backache, so I couldn't like really work that much. So I started sleeping on the bench, and my colleagues are asking, what's wrong? Started feeling feverish. So after some days, I then realized, I think after a day or two, I realized one of my colleagues, the one I work close to, she also started having the same symptoms. That was on a Monday. Tuesday, we came to work. I'm still not well. One of my other colleague again came complaining of the same thing. So we realized we're three, and we're just thinking, what's this? Is this a bug? What is it? Is it a flu? Is it nyongo? And you know, so we decided, guys, let's tell our boss. So we told our boss. Our boss says, do you think so? So funny enough, I was chatting to somebody, and they told me two of my friends are not feeling well. So I was now interested, what's wrong with them? Because, you know, we like go to the same church. So these were people that I actually sing with in the choir. So I phoned and I tried to find out what's wrong with them. Funny enough, same symptoms. So I said, no, this, it has something to do with COVID. Oh, it's nyongo, we don't know. So we actually told our boss, Kuti, no, actually I work at the church. So we told our pastor, we think we've got about 5 people that have got symptoms. As we're talking about it, somebody else in the church as well, who we work with again, was having same symptoms. So I think we are about 6 of us, 4 workmates and 2 members in the church. So the pastors agreed that I go for testing, since I was the one who started with symptoms. I went, I tested. But what happened was that I did rapid test, the one that they test IGAS, aren't it?
Yeah.
So the first one, that was on a Friday. Sorry, it was on a Tuesday. Actually, I tested negative to the rapid test. Then they said to us, but your symptoms, I think you just need to do a PCR. Or maybe probably tested negative because you came early, so you need to come after 7 days. After 7 days, I actually went back, and guess what? It was still negative. So I was excited. I don't have COVID. It's something else. So after that was on a Friday. After that, one of my pastors who had symptoms together also went for a rapid test. He was negative. Tuesday, we came to work, and one of the four was still not well. You could see that she's not well. Then our boss said, guys, I think let's do the PCR test, not the blood test. But we were still excited. We don't have COVID. But the fear was, if this one tests positive, what does it mean to us? So she was tested on a Tuesday. On a Wednesday. She was tested on a Wednesday. And then guess what? I'm sorry for that. Tested on a Tuesday. Results came on Wednesday. And guess what? They were positive. So that really shook us to say, why is she positive and we're negative? Then we phoned City Council. City Council did not take long. They were here around, we got results around 10. Then at 1 o'clock, City Council was here. We all got tested. I also managed to call the members of the church that had symptoms. We all got tested 5 days down the line. Well, results came out. And about 11 of us out of 14 tested positive. And I was one of them. So, yeah, that was traumatizing. So, but the procedure was quite, it was good. It was okay. We had our fears of saying this thing is painful, these things. But well, my experience was that it wasn't painful. It was just, there was just some discomfort, okay? From there, we were told to self-isolate and wait for City Council to come and test our families. So that was Wednesday. After about 6 days, City Council came home. They tested my family, and I was told, please prepare yourself. We were actually tested by an officer called Swanda. I'm not sure of his first name. And he told me to prepare. I was going to be taken away. That was traumatizing because I've got a four-year-old. I've got a four-year-old daughter. So I told him, you cannot take me away, because the picture I got was that wherever I'm going, I'm not coming back because I'm positive. And wherever I'm going, isolation center, people don't eat. Some people are given wrong injections and they die. So the picture I got was, I'm going to this place where people are sick, very sick. Others are coughing. So I'm also going to, you know, the virus is going to actually, you know, is a Ndebele, because I'm meeting other people that are sick. I was so afraid. I was so afraid, traumatized.
So why did they decide to say they're taking you away?
What happened when we were there, my daughter, I think, was coughing. And then he was saying, and I was also not wearing a mask at all. So he told me, most people are not abiding to the rules. So one, you're going to infect your family, you're going to infect people around, because people are moving up and down even when they're positive. So we need to take you and keep you somewhere until after about 10 days to 14 days. So, yeah, I was taken away, but with all that fear. The ambulance only came to my house at 9:30. You know, I was getting this thing of getting excited. You know, hey, praise the Lord. Because, you know, I've got boy children, sons, older sons. They were going to remain with the sister. So for me, that setup wasn't okay. I needed to be there for my daughter, but Swanda could not, you know, listen to me, of which it actually helped. And the good thing was that my children, the results came out negative. I didn't infect any of my children. It was only me. So in the evening, City Council phones, are you ready? We're coming to collect you. And I'm like, can't I talk to somebody? I do not want to go. Okay. So they said, no, we cannot change whatever has been said. We're coming to pick you. 9:30 they came. And the ambulance, you know, the ambulance, it didn't have a siren as such, but those lights, it's at night. And neighbors around, you know. Ha! My son said the ambulance is by the gate. So neighbors around are peeping. You can see people on the windows because of that. They are like, what's happening here? And then, so I took my bags. I went out. My daughter is crying. My heart is sore. I can't leave this girl. My daughter is literally crying. So I went to the gate. And there comes out this guy wearing, I'd never seen that, wearing, you know, the protective clothing. And, you know, so I'm like, So, what? I'm someone who's poisonous. But guess what? The ambulance driver said, ah, how are you? You know, he was very polite. He was very polite, extremely polite. And he's the one, I think, who changed my mindset. I can see you are walking, you being positive. This is what the guy said. I don't know his name. I know you are positive. I can see you are walking on your 2 feet. But where you are going, you are very safe. Did you carry your computer? Did you carry, because there's Wi-Fi? And I'm like, Wi-Fi at the hospital? Okay. Ah, okay. Don't panic. That's what he told me as I was entering the ambulance. He told me, don't worry. Don't. It's nothing. Where you are going, it's safe. This is to protect your family. So I'm like, ah, this guy is just trying to comfort me. So I went in there. You know, the thing that I'm in an ambulance. I'm not sick. I'm walking. What's happening? Okay. So there we go. We get to Elangen. And I'm like, oh my God, what's happening here? So we dropped off. They told me to carry my bags. And I'm like, okay, I'm poisonous. I carried my bags. I put them there. They told me to stand somewhere. You know, there were lines drawn, yellow lines, red lines. And I'm like, what's happening? Am I going to come out of this? So they went, they collected the nurse. And she came and... Voila, praise the Lord. Guess who I see? It's a member of our church. Like, what are you doing, you know? So I'm like, oh, praise the Lord. At least there's somebody I know. Took my details, asked, you know, she asked us a lot of questions. Yeah. From there, she went to show me my room. My first impression is, okay. Oh, all right, it looks nice. It's clean. I haven't seen anybody, it's just me. I'm in my room. The good thing was that the same ambulance was going to pick up a workmate. And I actually requested, I'm somebody who thinks too much, I need to have that person in my room, since there were two beds. They agreed. So there I am, I'm like, hesh, I'm so afraid, this place, this bed, COVID, who was sleeping here and was using these blankets. Very clean blankets, but still in my mind, I'm thinking, no. And we were told not to carry our linen, but I carried mine. So the nurse says, no, you can use the linen there. We've prepared your bed. Very clean setup. I took my blankets, I put on top of those blankets, and I was sleeping on my blankets, but our Elangen pants. Why? Because of the mindset. Because of what I was thinking, what's happening here. And I was not sure. I had my sanitizer with me. I sprayed the room. I sprayed everywhere, the windows, everywhere, the door. You know, I'm so afraid. Uti, who was using the bed? Who was using this room? Did they do anything? You know, so I'm looking, I'm thinking, Esh, I'm expecting sick people. I'm expecting people that, you know, I can hear some people coughing in other rooms, and I'm like, lapa, lapa nsugila. I had taken my kettle, you know, all I can say about where I was, I had my own kettle where I could boil my water and steam myself, okay? And I'm thinking, this is not a hospital setup. So the next morning, 6 o'clock, the nurse is calling out names. We're going for temperature check. And then I'm realizing the kind of people I'm seeing in the corridor. These guys are not sick. So what are we doing here? So I'm asking you, you're positive? Yes, I am. You're positive? Yes, I am. So I'm like interested. How did you get here? So, okay. They told me the experiences were in the queue, were taking... you know, I'm at temperature checks. And I got comfort. I realized there was a woman that I actually recognized, a pastor's wife from another church. And I'm like, oh, okay. Oh, wow. Then this lady is like, she works at Elangeni. She's telling us what to do, you know. How come you guys are sleeping, the two of you in the room? And I'm thinking, you guys are going to reinfect each other. And I'm like, no, mama, we work together with this lady. So vele sinigene M17, that's why we came here. But that lady gave us hope. And she's like, don't worry, after some days, they'll release you from here. And I'm like, okay, now I'm thinking, hey, Ndebele ugeza again. We went to the bathrooms, the toilet, clean stuff. The bathroom, extremely clean. And we're using showers, it's not a tub or anything. Water, it's hot water. And I'm like, okay, this is actually exciting. Though I'm still traumatized about leaving my children at home by themselves. So there I am. I'm happy with the showers. I'm happy with the toilets. From there, breakfast time. I didn't carry any food with me. So I'm like, hey, I wonder what we'll be eating here. So breakfast time, guess what we get? The same thing I eat at home. Bread, eggs, beans. So I'm like, okay. We'll see what we'll get at lunch. Tina Pelezinlin, things, you know, they're a bit tight, they're difficult.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't eat 3 meals a day. But that side, we're getting 3 meals. Lunchtime that day, my first meal. We actually had sadza with beef, I think, and vegetables. And I'm like, oh, wow, we love food. Wow. Supper, what will happen? Maybe probably it's beans or something. There's chicken. There's rice. And I'm like, I'm wondering, so who sponsors these things for us to eat? Who's doing this, you know? So I'm like, okay. It's not what I thought. Though my only problem psychologically is my kids at home, because I left the girl crying. So I'm thinking, so what else do we do here? I'm asking the ladies that were there. Fine, we sit social distancing and what we, you know, we follow the regulations. So I was so interested in knowing how others that have been there feel. My comfort was, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So all these people are positive. So Song is positive. Good. But what can we do to entertain ourselves? There's no TV. All you do is your phone, maybe your music. I love music, so I took my Bluetooth speaker with me. So that was part of my entertainment. So the ladies that were there, they really helped us, especially the pastor's wife. She encouraged us. And my mindset changed. So now I was trying to figure out, how can we entertain ourselves here? So I'm going to stay for the next 10 days. You know, the first day was not easy. Second day was not easy. Third, we're getting used. So I'm thinking, how best can we exercise? We've been only given a small place, you know, to sit. And then there are red lines that you are not supposed to pass. And when you are getting your food, it's a meter away. The nurse is giving you your food, you know, from the other line. And one of the good things that I loved about that place, I could get visitors. I could get food. I could get my pizza and stuff. You know, I'm a patient. I'm closed up.
So you are a patient, but you're on holiday.
Yes, yeah. I'm on holiday. People are bringing pizza for us. We're taking pizza photos and showing people back at home, you know. So to me, it was a holiday. And we actually called that thing quarantine vacation. That's what we called it. All we could do is, you wake up in the morning, go and bath, go for breakfast, lunch, supper.
The rest of the time you can play, you can sleep.
Sleep.
Yeah.
It was actually a time to reflect.
Yeah.
You know?
So, usually when you have, from my COVID experience, when you are self-isolating in your room, There are a lot of thoughts that come through because you're thinking, how am I going to? So for me, like I was telling other guys, that I stopped watching TV because each time you watch TV, CNN is talking about the number of people who have died, the cases have increased. I left WhatsApp because, you know, people will be having reckless, you know, comments on that. Do you think being in an isolation with other people with your condition really helped you mentally?
It helped me mentally. And what you're saying is very true. Guess what? My roommate, one evening, she's on social media. She's checking her phone. Then she says, ah, Sis Pesh, Kutwa Blawa has got the most deaths this month. Do you know what it did to us that day?
Yeah.
We boiled water, we put eucalyptus, we took turmeric and put milk, we drank, we started doing all the things that we need to, you know. It was like we're part of the guys that will die. So on social media, you're telling the truth. But somehow, somewhere as well, we needed the phone calls, the encouragement. But there's a danger with the guys that call us. Because the picture they have is that I'm very sick.
Yeah. There's also the issue of statistics. You know, every night, government gives out statistics.
Mm-hmm.
20 have died, 239 have tested positive. You know, there are no circumstances that these people, like if you look at these statistics and you're saying, okay, maybe from your church, 11 people tested positive. But I'm looking at the number that night that 11 people have tested positive from Bulawayo. Do you think there is a way that the government needs to, one, put faces, I don't know, but, you know, explain these statistics, so sometimes the numbers just send chills down the spine because they're just numbers. They don't mean anything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think mention the companies, mention the you know, like for us here, yeah, you don't have to really mention names or put people's faces unless they volunteer to. At least write down that Delta has got so many people that tested positive. City Pentecostal has got so many people that tested positive. I don't know. That's my thought.
Yeah. So you stay for 10 days at the isolation center.
Yes.
Yeah. Now it's time to get home. How is the, you know, how do people receive you? Do they run away from you or they welcome you?
Okay. Before we go there, I need you to understand this about Elangen as well. Before I went home, we entertained ourselves. Okay, we didn't just sleep, eat, wake up, go and bath. We sat down as positive people, and we told each other, guys, yeka, if we are going to sit and worry that you are positive, you are going to start coughing, because we were told that if your temperature goes up or you've got any headaches or anything, you're not feeling well, you're taken to Thorn Grove. The original picture that I had when I left home.
Yeah.
Okay. So we needed to encourage each other to keep, you know, to keep ourselves off this thing, our minds off this thing. So we decided, guys, we're actually calling each other. Guys, Mina, I was called COVID patient. COVID Tandy, COVID Trumbi, COVID so and so. Because we accepted our status because we are positive, okay? And then we told ourselves we are going to be positive-minded, guys. Our families at home are worried that we are kept somewhere. We might not come back. Take photos and send them home. Show them what we are doing. I don't know if you know, on social media, there's this Jerusalem dance that went around. Do you know that we actually had our own Jerusalem dance of positive people? We took time to dance every evening. We took time to dance just to remove our minds, kuti, we are not at home.
Thank you.
Shake them. And it was more like we're just on holiday. The food was great. The atmosphere was just so personal. I took time to reflect and look. You know, I'm a Christian. I started thinking, am I really in the right place with God? I had my Bible there. I had so much time to read the Bible. It was like time out to reflect. Peshi, are you really, if God was to take you today, are you really ready? I'm alone there. I took time to pray. I had so much to do for myself. No worry that what are we cooking? What are we eating today? Someone was taking care of that. So basically, I think personally, I did well at Elangeni because I started recruiting. We opened a WhatsApp group for COVID survivors, Blawai COVID survivors 2020. And that group is still functioning right now. We had students at at School of Mines. There were a lot of them. Do you know that every time we saw the ambulance coming, we celebrated like, you know, we've got new converts, you know, new inmates, you know, tell them, welcome new visitors. And I want to believe we've got testimonies of people that were like, you know, we're wondering, are these guys staff members at Elangeni? Only to be told they are patients just like you. They are also positive. So people that came in, were dancing there, they joined in. Samuel came in crying to think, why am I here? But the next day, we made them feel at home. And we made sure the day we left, we recruited somebody. We recruited Tandi. We recruited Rumbi. Rumbi, we need this group to continue. Guys, there's music. Remain with the speaker. Make sure the guys that are coming here don't feel bored. Don't feel like, you know, oh my God. Make them feel at home. So Elangeni to us was home. And on the day we were given our certificates, we called them. You know, there are certificates that you are given which you are being isolated.
Discharge, yeah.
Discharge. To us, we called that graduation day. So everybody during our period, that was there, we called that day graduation day.
So you leave Elang and you go home. How was it like?
It wasn't good. Okay, the day I left, I didn't want to leave because I was now home. The new guys that were coming in, I still wanted to interact. I still wanted to dance. I still wanted my quiet time in my room. But unfortunately, I had to go back home. That pain of leaving the children. So the day I left and got home, you know, stigma, it's not right. Because they really make us feel like there's something wrong with us. But because of where we were and what we told each other whilst we're at Elangeni, guys, you are going home, but remember the people you are going to meet, what's going to take place, what's going to happen. One of the things I learned, my children, they had no friends anymore because my neighbors were probably telling people that that house full of COVID.
Yeah, yeah.
So even when I got home and people were seeing me, you can tell that these people are talking about me. People would actually look, yes, people are pointing fingers, and I'm thinking.
For you when you're not even sick.
It wasn't Peter. I think there was a server. That house, people, and they, you know, my children used to sell airtime, but we had to stop because of that. So people just looking at us, they're thinking, they can't even come near us, but this is what we told each other whilst we're at isolation. Guys, we are safer without people around us, okay? We are positive, fine, but we're actually safer without people coming to see, to knock on my door. We don't need them. I know what to do with my family. I've tested positive. I've come back. What's next? Okay? So, stigma was the worst because my daughter, 4-year-old daughter, goes to play across the road and they tell her to come back home because the mother is positive. And that is very painful. That was the worst experience because the child do not understand, why am I being chased away? So it wasn't easy, but eventually people got used. And now I am helping people. I don't know how many people, if you have a relative that's positive, you tell them, let me give you a contact of somebody who was positive. Yeah. She will help you. Yeah. And people have been, you know, like contacting me, asking me things. What did you use? How was it? What did you feel? You know, things like that. And to me, it has really helped. Even Bonalama Devaleka, you know, from us at home. Now they ask, what did you use? What did you do? What? And I reply them. So, yeah, basically, I don't know.
So, finally, what would you say to someone who is contemplating the protest because they have symptoms? What would be your word about that?
It's better to know your status. Go and get tested, because one, it's, you are protecting your family, you are protecting Zimbabweans, you are protecting people that surround you. Knowing is better. You know what they say, there's this saying, the devil you know is better than you know. Yeah. So it's better to go and get tested and know, and then get isolated. Those that fear to go to isolation center, it's the best place they can be. They are better off at an isolation center. One, mentally, meeting other people that are positive, it changes you. It boosts your you know, it motivates you. So people should just get tested. Because COVID, it's not something that you choose not to have or to have. And it's not something, I was reckless and I got COVID. We just need to have a positive mind. For us to fight it, we need to act.